большое спасибо всем, кто пришел. Мы очень рады приветствовать здесь профессора Уордского университета Роджера Пенроуза, который будет участвовать в круглом столе под названием «Нужна ли новая физика, чтобы объяснить мозг?». У нас сейчас, давайте я коротко по-русски, прежде чем я перейду на английский, скажу, как все будет устроено. Значит, вся основная часть будет идти по-английски. Сначала каждый из участников, которых я уже представлю сразу после этого короткого введения, сделает небольшое выступление где-то на 10-12 минут, и после этого профессор Пенроуз это прокомментирует. Это все займет примерно полтора часа, и все будет происходить по-английски. После этого у нас будет небольшой перерыв, минут 10, после чего будет вторая часть, которая начнется с того, что те же участники обменяются репликами небольшими. На это я где-то рассчитываю 30-40 минут, и после этого мы уже будем брать вопросы из зала. И в этой части я могу, те, кому сложно пользоваться английским языком, я смогу что-то перевести. Вот так. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. But again, we are really honored to host here Professor of Mathematics of Oxford University, Sir Roger Penrose, who will participate in a round table titled "Is New Physics Needed to Understand the Mind?" And you already know that Professor Penrose would going to argue that it is needed indeed. And so I present now all other participants just in alphabet order. So it's member by correspondence of Russian Academy of Science, Konstantin Anokhin from Kurchatov Institute. Then it's a member of Russian Academy of Science, Vladislav Liktorsky from this institute, the Institute of Philosophy. Then Professor Mikhail Mensky from Physical Institute of Academy of Science. Then Professor Alexander Panov from Moscow State University. And Tatiana Chernigovskaya from Kurchatov Institute and St. Petersburg State University. So we'll begin with a short talk, short presentation by Alexander Panov. So please, and I just keep the schedule.
Thank you very much. Yes, yes. I would like to say some words about incomputable activity of human brain and about physical foundations of this incomputable activity. Yes, yes. Sorry. Lower. Ближе. Yes, yes. Okay. I start with the Gödel-Turing theorem. The Gödel-Turing theorem states that for any finite-state machine, in other words, a usual computer, there is a meaningful proposition that cannot be verified by this machine. The description of structure of a finite-state machine is something very similar to a finite number of axioms of an axiomatic mathematical theory. And the Gödel-Turing theorem is very similar to the well-known Gödel incompleteness theorem about axiomatic systems. I would like to say that there is nothing unexpected or strange in the Gödel-Turing theorem about finite-state machines. At the same time, the Gödel-Turing theorem says nothing about human thinking. However, Sir Roger Penrose proved that the Gödel-Turing theorem actually implicates that for any finite-state machine, the brain of mathematician can do something that this machine cannot do. A human brain carries out some incomputable activity. Therefore, any finite state machine cannot simulate human intelligence. And human brain is not simply usual classical computer. I would like to call this statement no-go Penrose theorem about artificial intelligence. And I would like to emphasize that it is not the same as the original Gödel-Turing theorem. No-go Penrose theorem is much stronger than Gödel-Turing theorem. A misleading mix of Gödel-Turing theorem and no-go Penrose theorem is rather widespread. But it is absolutely invalid to mix these notions for me. The proof of the theorem is actually very simple and transparent, and everybody can find it in Roger Penrose's books. And I completely agree with this theorem. However, what is the physical origin of incompleteness activity of brain? Roger Penrose argued that any process of classical physics, including classical mechanics, classical field theory, and even classical statistical physics, are computable and cannot be an origin of incomputable activity of brain. I completely agree with these arguments as well. Moreover, Roger Penrose argued also that usual quantum theory, like quantum mechanics, quantum field theory, also is computable theory. Therefore, it cannot be origin of incomputable activity of brain as well. Now, what we have? Obviously, we must search some unknown in computable physics to understand the operation of brain. And this is conclusion of Roger Penrose. I supposed that there is one subtle point in this conclusion. Actually, quantum theory is computable from formal point of view, of course. There are no something incomputable in unitary transformations of vectors of Hilbert space. It is just a matrix production, or in other formalism, it may be a solution of linear different equations. But actually, many quantum systems is not computable in our universe in a very strong and strict sense. For example, the state of 1,000th qubit quantum computer is represented by 2 to the 1,000th complex amplitudes, complex numbers, and such a large number of information cannot be stored in memory of any classical computer, even if one bit of memory of this computer is located in each Planckian cell of physical space within the whole cosmological event horizon in all visible universe. Such a computer is not simply large or very large. It cannot exist at all in our universe in principle. It is a very fundamental physical restriction. There is a strict cosmological horizon of computations, and computability of complex quantum systems is essentially beyond this physical horizon. Complex quantum systems is not computable from the physical point of view. The quantum brain should be, of course, a very complicated quantum system, it is clear. And this complex quantum system is not computable in the sense of cosmological horizon of computations. Therefore, from a physical point of view, of an observer located in our universe, quantum evolution of brain should be considered as strictly incomputable in the sense of cosmological horizon of computability. May it be that such sort of incomputability is exactly the incomputability predicted by the no-go Penrose theorem about artificial intelligence. From the point of view of pure mathematics, it is not the case, obviously. Pure mathematics does not support the notion of cosmological horizon of computations. But human brain is not a mathematical object. We deal with a physical system, and we must adopt a physical point of view to computability of the activity of brain. Which point of view is valid, pure mathematical or physical? I'm not sure, I don't know. But my opinion is that using quantum physics as possible origin of incomputable activity of brain is not ruled out yet. But some new incomputable physics is not excluded as well, of course. Thank you very much.
It is honor for me to participate in this seminar or round table with very important remark which I can give is that what is the meaning of the word consciousness which I will use in my talk. This is the most fundamental level of consciousness, namely distinction between something subjected to consciousness or not subjected to consciousness. This is not processes which can be performed on the background of consciousness. This is very important because most often consciousness is meant as processes in consciousness, but not for me. Now the question, very hard question, what is consciousness as such? What is this fundamental level of consciousness? There is no clear answer to this question, and I hope, and many people hope, that quantum mechanics can help to answer this important and very difficult question. So, a small history of relation between quantum mechanics and consciousness. The history began by works of Pauli and Jung, psychologist and physicist. They worked on the strange phenomenon of synchronicities and hoped to explain it by quantum mechanics. Nowadays, the topic of consciousness and quantum mechanics was strongly supported by Sir Roger Penrose. And in the, as a starting point of this, of consideration of Penrose, was the phenomenon of intuition. This topic, quantum mechanics and consciousness, is very important in many reasons. First of all, it concerns the deepest aspects of reality. This concerns human perception and mysterious conception, mysterious phenomena of life. this phenomenon of what is intuition? Penrose started from the from some evidences of great scientists that the most important achievements of them was connected with spontaneous and unexpected insights which came seemingly nowhere. It is not clear what is the origin of these events, these insights. And I shall try to explain how quantum mechanics can make this question more clear. This will be done on the basis of so-called Everett's interpretation of quantum mechanics, and the quantum concept of consciousness will be elaborated as extended Everett concept. So, the main point of Everett interpretation is that different classical realities coexist. They coexist in the form of superposition, quantum superposition of quantum states of the world. There are different verbal formulations of this statement, but I consider that most convenient is a formulation that alternative classical realities objectively coexist, but they are only classical projections of quantum mechanics. And they, these projections are separated between each other in consciousness. In consciousness helps to separate these alternatives, so that each one is seems to be a single one. And now let's make a small step. Instead, the statement alternatives are separated in consciousness, we shall accept another formulation. Consciousness is identical to separation of the alternatives. Seemingly small step, but it has many interesting consequences. And this is the main point of the extended Everett concept, which I suggested in 2000. Yeah. So the more detailed formulation of this main point is: consciousness is an ability to perceive the objectively coexisting alternatives separately from each other. This is, in a sense, definition of consciousness. But consciousness in that meaning which I mentioned earlier. Then logically follows from this definition some new phenomenon which can be called superconsciousness. So if consciousness is separation of the alternatives, then what is no consciousness? And no consciousness mean sleeping, trance or meditation. What is no consciousness? If consciousness is separation of the alternatives, then no consciousness means that there is no separation between alternatives. They are all together. So that we have some of some nature access to all alternatives together. Consequences which follow from this is, first, access to all alternatives in all times, really in all times, I can't prove this immediately, but this follows from deterministic evolution in quantum mechanics. Then, if we have, put part of the information obtained in this great database, all alternatives together, if get bring part of this information into consciousness in the usual state of mind when it is conscious, then we have origin for super intuition. So the insights which have no ground in all information we have in our conscious state. So we don't understand what is the origin of these insights, but really it is in quantum reality as a whole, not separated. And in fact, this conclusion is confirmed by human experience. It is confirmed by religions, great religions, by oriental philosophies, and by deep psychological practices. This is illustration of what I have said. If we have, according to American interpretation, generally, the state of the world is the superposition of several or many or infinite number of alternative classical reality. So, but if we have consciousness, then these alternatives are separated. So they are perceived independently from each other, and illusion arises that there is only one, only a single alternative. But if consciousness is weakened, then this separation is weakened. And when we perceive one of the alternatives, then we have also some access to other alternatives. Okay, so, concluded. Consciousness logically follows from quantum mechanics. It is confirmed by psychological experience. It belongs both spheres of matter and sphere of spirit. What I have said, what I have overlooked shortly, briefly, is not reduction to physics, consciousness to physics, but a sort of psychophysical parallelism. Brain is an interface between consciousness and body, and consciousness is not physical conception in this context. But it can be shown that first steps can become this conception, consciousness closer to physics. But for this we need the whole world, we need to consider the whole world as one of the physical systems. This is close to the notion of microcosm, but this maybe includes quantum gravity, some ideas of quantum gravity, and this is again parallel to ideas of Penrose. Okay, and generalization of all this is possible from consciousness to life as a whole. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I would like to say that The problem of consciousness is now being studied in multi-disciplinary perspective by many special sciences, including cognitive sciences, neurosciences, and maybe physics, in particular quantum mechanics. And so there are a lot of many new ideas, and I think that in this context, the book by Professor Penrose is very interesting, very stimulating. But I would like to draw your attention to the fact that the problem of consciousness was studied or discussed for many, many centuries in philosophy. And I think that in philosophy, some very peculiar features of this phenomenon were formulated, were selected, and philosophers continue to participate in these discussions now, and I think that the main problem which is connected with this participation of philosophers in this discussion about the possibility of studying consciousness is as follows. It is not only a problem of what can physics, in particular quantum mechanics, to do for brain sciences. It is a very important problem. But there is another problem. This problem is what can it do? What are our understanding of the very phenomenon of consciousness? It's possible also to formulate this problem in such a way. Can consciousness be a subject of scientific study in general? Because it's a very peculiar phenomenon. You see, it's very distinct from all other phenomena which are object of our usual knowledge and of all sciences also. Because, for example, consciousness have such very, very specific features as follows. Everybody know about her or his own consciousness, about the states of his consciousness, about the essential objects of his consciousness, about what to have consciousness or to lose consciousness, about such phenomena as attention, as intention, as volition. It's possible to make free choices and to make deeds. How is it possible? It is very, 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 very strange. It is impossible to be. It is every act of consciousness has its bearer, which is called self or ego. Yeah? It is impossible to be mistaken about your own ego or self. You can be mistaken about intentional objects of yourself, including such cases when you are intentional objects of your own. But it is impossible to misidentify the theory of the subjects of all these intentional acts. So this very strange phenomenon. You have so-called perspective for the first person, because all kinds of knowledge usually are obtained from the perspective of the third person. But in the case of consciousness, you have a perspective from the first person. So when a student heard lectures on philosophy, and after one of the lectures he came to a professor, he asked the professor, "You see, sometimes it seems to me that I don't exist." "But to whom it seems?" professor asked. "To me, therefore you exist." So it is a very peculiar so-called position from the first person. So the problem is, how it is possible to study in scientific manner this so-called position from the first person? Is it possible? In principle, maybe consciousness is not a subject from scientific studies, in distinction from all other subjects. So, it is so-called hard problems of consciousness, because consciousness have some phenomenal qualities, so-called qualia. Is it possible to explain qualia from scientific point of view? So, some authors, you know them, they're very popular now, not in abroad, but in my country also, think that the so-called hard problems of consciousness cannot be studied in visual scientific manner. So it is to suppose that consciousness exists primordially. It has roots in the epoch of the universe. So-called some psychic conceptions, which seem until recently our fashion is have become popular again. And I think I don't share this position because I think it is possible to investigate or study consciousness from a scientific point of view. But I think that in this connection, this take into consideration that, well, in fact, the functions of the functioning of consciousness is impossible without brain activities. And maybe from the back understanding of these brain activities, the functions of brain, it is necessary, maybe it is fruitful to take into account some new approaches in quantum mechanics also, maybe it can explain something, but the brain activities is a necessary condition from the distinct of consciousness, but as to the nature of consciousness, the norm, I think it is possible to understand them if you take into account also that it can be understood in the formal point of view, the framework of all representational theory of consciousness. It is connected with information, understanding of consciousness, states, and events. And I think that I can show it, but now that it is possible to show that so-called qualia can be understood in the framework of this approach. It is possible to show how it is possible to have so-called the position from the first perspective. It is possible from the position of the first perspective to show how this position of the first perspective arrives, how it is possible. So I think that it is connected with the idea that so it is necessary to take into account in other way the relations between a cognizing being, it can be a human being, but not only human being, but other living being also. It is possible to take into account the relations, not only between conscious phenomena, but also between this cognizing being and the world. This relations between organism, its brain, and its relations with the world, information relations, and activity relations, because they are interconnected. In this relation, it's possible to show also that the so-called the obtaining of information from the world is connected with the information from the cognizant being itself also. Interdependent between these two domains of information. And I think it is also very important now, and there are corresponding researchers in this field, to take into account also that knowledge and consciousness can exist not only in conceptual and categorized forms, as it is usually, but also in non-conceptual. I think if you take into account this approach, I think it is possible to say that consciousness and self-consciousness presuppose each other, and that some kinds of non-perception of consciousness can be noted in this human emancipation, but among other living things also. So I think that it is possible to practice scientific approach to the phenomenon of consciousness. They are very, very complicated. And I think that the different types of disciplines, such as different cognitive sciences, brain sciences, neurosciences, maybe physics also, can contribute a lot to this very, very hard problem. It is hard problems, but from my point of view, it is not unexplainable, and I think that it is possible to understand consciousness not to, without using a hypothesis about part psychism and about the impossibility to scientifically understand this phenomenon. So, for my point of view, it is a challenge to science, to many sciences, which is dealing now with human beings, consciousness, in some new stations in the world of science, and maybe quantum mechanics can contribute to this research also. But it is not very clear for me how it is important, how it is possible to explain, to understand such specific features of consciousness about which I said with the help of my ideas of quantum mechanics. Thank you.
So our next speaker is Professor Chimingu.
Is it functioning?
Yes.
So my short talk will be very close to what Professor Liktorsky said. But I'll try to make it more or less structured. I would say that the main problem, we have two main problems. One is the definition of consciousness. Dramatic controversy in the results that different sciences give us is probably about that. We have no consensus on what we understand when we pronounce any term, whether it's consciousness or mind or awareness or reflexivity or being awake, and it's not the whole list. So I would say that till the time when we stop somewhere, we shall get all these controversial results and approaches. The other problem that I see is can there be experimental verifications of thought experiments, even theoretically? Can we get experimental evidence that prove this or that hypothesis to be true? I do not know the result of it. So Roger brings consciousness into physics, and he has opponents from philosophers like David Chalmers, who argues against quantum consciousness, and up to physicists like Max Tegmark and some others, who say that cold numbers unmake quantum mind. We have no time to discuss it now, but it's about the temperature of the mind and the speed of neural processes that do not cope with quantum world. What troubles me in this connection is the problem of free will, because the problem of causality is there. If it's a metaphor to compare quantum events and what is going on in microtubules, then it's okay. But if it's a real physical comparison, then I feel kind of nervous. And my question is whether it can be proved. Do we really have any evidence about superpositions in a quantum sense of events that occur in microtubules? Do we have evidence, or we are just telling the story? Backward time effects in the brain that come from this position are very troubling, I would say. Again, do we have any evidence of backward time effects? If there are such, then there is causal paradox, don't they? And we cannot simply pass it. It's a serious point. So if we look at Buddhist descriptions of consciousness, we read there something like that consciousness is the sequence of discrete events. So I hint on the fact that there are different traditions describing consciousness, even in theoretical strata. And being at the Institute of Philosophy, I want to stress, and that it's not politeness, I'm absolutely serious, that the main player here is an analytical philosopher. I'm absolutely sure that if an analytical philosopher is not involved, we can get tons and tons and billions of facts, and we won't know what to do with it. And of course, the problem of qualia and of first-person experience very difficult. Probably my friend and colleague, Professor Anokhin, will tell us. But I simply can't imagine how can we study this in the paradigm of natural sciences. How can we get this information about first-person experience? And the question that is connected with this is whether consciousness or mind is human-specific, or it is spread all over the universe. There is pre-consciousness, there are some variants of consciousness in all the living beings. And again, we come to my first word. It's all about definition. We should settle it. We should agree at some point. We have some weak or strong, probably weak, consensus about what we are talking about. When I give lectures to my students at St. Petersburg State University, I often tell them, if a magician comes and tells me, I'll give you what you want. Let's go to the Institute of Human Brain, with whom I cooperate every day, and we shall show you whatever you ask for. And then it all stops, because I do not know what to ask for. Because whatever they show me, I can say, it was attention, this was memory, these were associations, these were just reflections of some kind, etc., etc., etc. So, and again, the huge arguing, the everlasting discussion about whether consciousness is human-specific will never, ever last till we give these definitions. Because if it's about reflexivity, then it's more or less human. And again, we do not know, because we do not have first-person experience from cats and wolves and monkeys. We simply do not know. If to recall a very famous, years ago, theoretical biologist, von Uexküll, he invented a term which is Umwelt. So his main idea was that any human, not human, any living being has its or his or hers Umwelt. So a separate world which is not transparent to any others. And so, again, it's about what we mean when we say consciousness or mind. when I was listening to all my colleagues, I was thinking, is it consciousness that they are talking about? Probably it's mind, or being awake and not sleeping. You were talking about sleep, but are you sure that there is no consciousness in sleep? I'm not. Because it's a very... Yes, so definitely not zero. Yes, do you agree? So, I think I should stop here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, and so the last speaker from the Russian group is Professor Arnold.